All right, and that is going to do it for me. I'm High Def Low Main, also known as Dave, the AV guy for my boys in the Spelunky group. I'm going to hand it over here to Zach, who's going to take over hosting for this next block of games. It's been great. Thanks for having me, and I'll see you again tonight, starting with Contra 3. But in the meantime, here's Freedom Planet.
So welcome. This is a Freedom Planet. This is run by Fladervy. Fladervy is up there, and we are back here. I'm Johan Howitzer. This is Kirby Masta and Ghoul02. This is a run that's been... we didn't know if it was going to happen because Fladervy had some major difficulties getting his paperwork to get here from Brazil. He got his visa finally on Thursday, so he was just barely able to make it, just barely had enough money to get himself here, so this has been a long anticipated run. Mila is, the Lilac run last year was something, but then Mila is just in a class by herself. She's several minutes faster, and she's much, much harder, and Flattervy's going to be running on hard mode, which doubles the damage he takes. Want me to count you down? You ready?
You can count down.
All right, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Right away, you're going to see a lot of these lasers. When Mila shoots a laser, she has to have a block already created to make that laser. And it can be shot in 6 different directions, everywhere, every direction but up and down. And it causes recoil. So this was a mechanic that was suggested when the game was in alpha by HDL, I believe. And it turned out to be one of the main things Mila uses to move around because it was so powerful before the game was released. I think it was before the game was released, but they actually had to nerf this particular ability by giving it a speed cap. So as fast as you're seeing Fladervy move through this stage, before it was capped, you could move 2 or 3 times faster than this. The cardinal rule in Freedom Planet is if you're moving up, you're slowing down. The game will decelerate you when it detects you're moving upward, with a few exceptions. One exception is if you're accelerating while you're moving upward. For example, if he's recoiling upward with a laser boost that is pointed downward, he'll be accelerating until that acceleration finishes. He won't have any air drag, but as soon... Oh, here we go. So, Mila's flutter has some interesting properties. Even playing this game casually, you may have run into a glitch in Fortune Knight where if you land on a sloped surface while fluttering, like you're falling, but you're fluttering and slowing your descent, you haven't started moving upward yet. It puts Mila into kind of a glitched state. And that was a transition skip right there. There's a lot to talk about. Hopefully I can cover some of it down the road here. Mainly, a lot of times the laser recoil will be used in such a way that he'll crash into a ceiling because that will stop him moving upward, which means he'll keep all the speed. If there isn't a ceiling available, he may opt for a horizontal recoil instead. First boss here, this is kind of an auto-scroller sort of thing. Boss opens his mouth, he can be hit. He can be hit by a bomb at any time. So you might also have noticed this is a different stage than we started out with Lilac. This is Aqua Tunnel, Mila's first stage. She's the only character currently that plays this stage. A few stages in the game are character exclusive.
She's trying to celebrate while being on the slope.
So one of the things you saw in the previous stage was he launched himself into the air above a platform. You're about to see it again here. He launched himself into the air, and then as he was coming down, he used another laser to propel himself harder downward and started a flutter just before hitting the ground, like right here. It's pretty precise. This is a few frames at most, and it's a difficult cue. Ah, oh, almost got it there. When Mila's flutter, normally you would zip upward in this game because the game is trying to make you fall, and the zips happen opposite the way the game's physics want you to move.
I thought I
when
it.
He's when he's fluttering. Finally. There we go. Yeah. As long as that might take to get, sometimes it skips two side rooms, so it is still a time savings. And the reason he was like right here too as well. That one's much easier because the terrain is much thinner. Okay. All right, I didn't realize. So in Skype, we should have Strife, the lead dev of Galaxy Trail, the developers behind this game.
Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
So we know that HDL was responsible for the idea of the laser recoil.
Yeah, he was one of our first play testers, and back when I was making Mila, I was thinking of different abilities that she could have, and I came up with the shield and the block throwing. Mm-hmm. And then we just kind of came up with the idea of like combining the two abilities by having her shoot a super shield when she summons a block. Mm-hmm. And that ended up turning her into a really versatile character with the way that you can use her recoil to build up speed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and actually... her shield theme is really useful. She can reflect a surprising number of projectiles in the game, and a surprising number of them will also hurt what you bounce them back at.
Yeah, that I kind of imagine her as like a character who has like who's like physically weak, but can reflect projectiles back at enemies. So yeah. She relies more on turning enemies' attacks against them. So she's kind of the mage type.
Yeah, and Fladervy, because Mila's health is so low and he's playing on hard mode, he's going to spend quite a bit of time in this run at zero health. The game has zero health forgiveness, which means that the game cannot kill you unless you were already at zero health when you got hit. If you had more than zero health, then it will first take you to zero health.
Yeah, there's some bosses in this game where I figured it'd be really frustrating if you got killed above zero health.
It means that it's really easy... to provide yourself just that one extra hit that you need to survive by just picking up a single pickup for health.
Yeah, exactly.
Just want to mention that the devs for Freedom Planet, Strife especially, have been very very good about listening to speedrunner concerns while still balancing that with the concerns of the casual player. One example is in this boss, Mantelith. There was a skip that was found where you could skip an entire phase by hitting him during a jump when his eyes were red. Hitting him during a jump would cause him to be vulnerable on the way down again. And the devs... the devs patched that because it was... a really stupid trick to have to get while not like ruining the experience for casual players. I know your philosophy is to take things out if they're dumb for speedrunners without harming the casual experience.
Yeah, my philosophy with speedrunning tactics and like bugs that they use, my tactic is that if it's random, then I usually patch it out, but if it's something that can be performed somewhat consistently, then I might as well just leave it in.
Some of the dumb things that have been found lately that are just extremely precise to get, impractically precise to get, unfortunately is not something that can really be patched very well, because most of them are zips, and that's a notoriously, practically impossible thing for a developer to patch, because it just takes advantage of the way the game's platforming physics engine works, the typical ejection.
Yeah, the best I can do is to like try to find specific instances of zipping in like specific locations, and then like try and like manually push them out.
So the trick that Fladervy just did, where he, we call it a wrong warp. It's a transition that takes you where you're not supposed to go. He's about to do another one here. There's two of them in Fortunite and Fortunite alone. Now, I think you've told us before that you don't know exactly why this happens.
No, it's kind of weird. Like you fight one of the bulldozer enemies, and that somehow gets you to warp to the wrong location.
As far as we can tell, it's because we're hitting the loading sequence twice. Like we're hitting the trigger
twice.
Yeah,
I think that might make sense.
When you hit a transition zone, the characters go into auto walk mode, so that they'll walk off the screen naturally. But in the case with the bulldozer and Lilac, we bonk off of the bulldozer. So we hit the loading zone trigger, so they're in, Lilac's in auto walk mode, and then she keeps walking forward after she recoils. So she may, it may be because she's hitting the loading zone trigger twice.
Yeah.
Another thing about Mila's flutter, I love the flutter just because of how it functions when you're falling, because it decelerates your fall before it starts moving you upward. This is the reason a lot of the zips work, because it looks like what's happening is that as she's falling and then starts fluttering, the game isn't checking as actively for collision below her.
Yeah, it's because when she's fluttering, she's always in a state where she's in the air, even though she might be touching the ground.
Yeah. So that fact that it decelerates like that, it not only allows for the zips to happen, but it also allows for Fladervy to tap the flutter button rapidly while she's descending, which will keep from moving upwards, so she's not losing any speed, but also slow her descent.
Mm. Yeah, normally during this fight with the other characters, Mila flies in on the plane above and throws health pickups for the player.
Yeah.
But here you get to control her. So there's a lot more freedom of movement since you're on the plane instead of running on the ground.
Interesting thing about this fight, Carol can't lose the bike in this fight, and Lilac is in auto run. She will constantly be running. Mila's on the plane, so she's not programmed to be an auto run animation. And can you do it? It might be too late.
It's too late.
Oh man. Okay, so something happened in the practice rooms that really surprised Ghoul. He was like, can you hack the game so that Mila would be running along the ground? And then immediately Fladervy did the zip through the plane and landed on the ground. And as it turns out, this particular fight, because she's programmed to stand still on the plane and not be in running animation, you can get on the ground with the ground going miles per hour underneath her, and she'll just be standing there like it's nothing.
Yeah.
You haven't really seen it yet, but Mila can do infinite flight. I don't know if you knew about this, Strife. But there's a same frame trick. This is a thing that happens often in video games, where you'll have two inputs that aren't really programmed to interact with each other when they happen on the same frame, so there's no way for the game to handle it. Normally, when you're carrying a block, you can't flutter. So you see it right here when he's fighting this mini-boss, how he's creating a block while he's fluttering. That happens because he's pressing the block creation button and the flutter button on the same frame.
As a result
of that, he can flutter and then laser recoil, and then flutter and laser recoil and fly infinitely.
Yeah, like normally she has like this invisible stamina value that decreases whenever she flutters.
Yep. Eventually
but, like,
you will run out.
My best guess is that when she goes into the block summoning animation, her stamina resets.
Mm-hmm. So, somebody, because this is the only stage, the Sky Battalion is the only stage that's open air, like around the stage is just open air. Somebody, I forget who it was, but somebody went and flew under the ships to complete the stage with Mila.
Yeah, I kind of anticipated that might be possible. when you're building these levels, you just kind of have to like prepare. If you make a ship, for example, and there's space underneath it, you should always just kind of anticipate that people will find a way to go under the ship.
Which, by the way, when he's zipping out of bounds in later stages here, pay close attention to the terrain outside the stage, because you guys left some things in. Like, we found some rather irregular terrain outside of bounds, some objects that looked like they were left there for testing purposes. Like in
I guess you can just consider that a little bonus Easter egg.
Yeah. In Relic Maze, there's an invisible hang bar under one of the cave screens. It functions as a hang bar, but there's no visual for it.
Oh.
Mm.
Oh.
I think I know which one you're talking about.
Yeah, it's the screen with the railway. It's right after the train chase. Because you can get under the first rail like he did in the speedrun. You can also get under the rail below that, which is just death below you, so you can't really get back up. But you can fly around down there with infinite flight. There's lots of interesting stuff down there. Mila.
And normally when you leave.
Mila has like
when you leave one of the ships.
Yeah.
Oh, no, you go first.
Well, on this boss, Mila has a tendency to shred bosses pretty fast because her laser and the block are both the highest damage per tick in the game. And Mila's laser covers quite a bit of ground. So as you see in this fight, she's able to clear all of the Thunderbird's feathers with two lasers. And that's one of only two times he'll throw a flower in the game on purpose. The other one was earlier in this stage to kill a cannon. In the third phase of this fight, the Thunderbird was about to become invincible and do a spread laser attack, which you won't see because he skipped it. The health flower, throwing that at the boss's head, for some reason bypasses the boss's immunity.
Yeah, the item boxes actually do a decent amount of damage if you can find one to throw. Yeah, like I was saying before, like in this stage, whenever you leave... beat the boss on one of the ships, normally the airplane comes to pick you up, but you can actually like go to the right of the screen on your own to go to the next ship.
Yeah.
And there's actually an achievement if you do that and like completely skip using the plane.
A lot of the achievements in the game were things that were found during testing, and they decided to leave them in and just make them an achievement for some people who found them by accident.
It's not a bug, it's an achievement.
Yeah. And as you heard at the end of that stage after beating Thunderbird, Mila, according to her own words, is in fact a super dog. So the transition skip there, what he's doing is the same thing as the recoil out of the screen transition for the wrong warp, and then pausing as the screen goes dark and hitting restart functions differently than restarting does normally. Normally, restarting warps you back to a checkpoint and costs you a life. In this situation, restarting does not cost you a life and won't, like, normally when you restart, you also lose shield, so you will keep a shield. But it causes the next screen to load faster. It saves in-game time every time and real time if you execute it well.
And you can see I'm not doing this in every single screen.
Yeah.
Screen transition. Oh, okay.
The Mila's laser recoil is a bit like wave dashing, I've been told. I'm not a Smash player, but what you have to do is form a block over your head. You have to have a block to do it. And then you jump, form a shield, turn it backward, let go of the shield, and then turn forward again. So there's five steps after forming the block. And it's really easy to mistime it, to get some of the steps out of order somehow. And sometimes you'll see Fladervy infinite flight to just hover around the boss here. Sometimes you'll see Fladervy use the laser in the wrong direction. That's just something that even the best players struggle with because there's so much involved in each recoil boost. It's really easy to turn around by accident, and if you recoil backward, then you lose all your speed. It's a really devastating mistake to make.
Yeah, I couldn't really figure out how to make it like a little more simple to pull off, short of actually like making the laser go in the opposite direction you're facing.
It's a really intuitive thing to use, like to figure out though, because I think all four of us here on camera figured out the recoil boosting was a thing when we first played the game independently of each other and without no outside information. We just said, that's a recoil. I wonder if we can use that to go fast. And it turns out we can.
Awesome. Yeah, that's what I like to hear.
Yeah. Now, there's two things I like to see in games as far as speedrunning goes. One is giving the player a lot of diverse tools. And that's something this game does really well. It gives the player a whole bunch of different options to move around. When you think of really strong speed games, you think of things like Super Metroid or Super Mario 64. And both of those games also give the player a lot of movement options. This game does that as well. And it also gives a number of options to fight an enemy. So when you see Lilac fight from the video last year, you'll see a lot of flips and tricks, not just straight up dragon boosting through the boss. You'll see a lot of creativity. And Mila doesn't have as many tools overall. She has like half the tools that Lilac has, if you counted them up. But she has about as many options as Lilac for fighting an enemy. There's like the straight damage per second. I think the highest thing is the small shield, spamming that. But whenever like there's downtime when you can't hit a boss, then you want to charge up a laser or form a block at least. And block is a bit faster than laser. Just laser hits can hit more times. So it's all
it's no secret that like Freedom Planet was inspired by Sonic.
Yeah.
And one of the things I wanted to do to like differentiate us from the way a Sonic game would play is like the increased focus on combat and like fighting abilities. So that's why the characters have like a more versatile moveset than what you might see in like the old Genesis Sonic games. Yeah.
And a lot of those fighting options ended up turning into strong movement options. Like they serve a double purpose, and because you put extra fighting moves into the game, it actually filled out the movement set. So this stage was really not made for Mila. This is Carol's stage. It feels like it was designed for Carol. There's a lot of walls to climb up.
Yeah, I had Carol specifically in mind. Mm-hmm.
And as a result, this is one of Mila's harder stages. Which is, it's really cool to watch.
Since Mila already had Aqua Tunnel as an exclusive stage, I figure I might as well just have her go here. Because she has no reason to be in Tengu Lagoon like Lilac.
Yeah. This is the second stage you're going to see in this run. The second and last stage that is unique to Mila as opposed to Lilac. Lilac does not play this stage. This is Trap Hideout. I'm curious, between this tune and the Mahjong minigame, was Jamiroquai one of your musical influences?
That's probably a question for our musician.
Okay.
Leela. She's the one who did most of the soundtrack.
Yeah.
I collaborated with her with like some of the melodies and stuff, but by and large it's her work.
Okay. Yeah, I know. I don't exactly know which things were done by you and which were done by her.
Yeah, there were a few like smaller songs here that are still like 90% mine, but like most of the soundtrack is arranged by her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, there's a sequel that's been announced for this game, Freedom Planet 2, and the word from you guys officially, I think, is that there may be an alpha available next year sometime.
Yeah, I want to try and get a demo out like sometime early next year or like at the end of this year.
Okay. Because I've been listening to Wuffle has Layla Wilson is her screen name is Wuffle did a lot of the music for this game, and she's also doing the soundtrack for Freedom Planet 2, and she has a SoundCloud playlist.
Yeah.
And I've been listening to that quite a bit. The music is really good.
Yeah, she did a good job on it. And we're also have another musician on board who's helping to master the soundtrack.
Oh, cool.
Sound nice and crisp.
All right, we're in thermal base
and,
now.
And in terms of the characters.
Yeah.
Oh, you go first.
We're in thermal base now. This is one of Mila's hardest stages. There's a lot of really precise tricks in here. There's a lot of sources of high damage. You notice Mila just grabbed a metal shield through the wall. Metal shield, each shield has, there's five different shields, and each of them has just straight damage reduction. It'll ignore the first two hits for Mila on hard mode. And it also has a feature, like a special feature and an immunity. The metal shield's immunity is spikes, so he can just ignore spikes, which is important in a couple places coming up. So there's a zip right there, another box zip.
I wanted to try and make it so that if you somehow end up outside the stage, it would actually act as water, but I couldn't really figure it out without messing up the inside part.
That would actually have been kind of annoying.
yeah.
Because Mila spends so much time in this stage out of bounds. In a lot more places than you may be expecting after having seen Lilac last year. Because, like, Mila is the master of zips, where Lilac is really flashy. She has a lot of flips and tricks and things. Mila is broken. She can break so many stages in so many ways. Lilac can do a lot of her zips, but there's most of them Mila is exclusive to those zips. So
I guess that kind of fits her Google personality.
So instead of using her energy as a shield, she just uses the entire stage as a shield from the enemies. All right, this trick can take a few tries, but it's really cool if we can get it. Same deal as before, where he's exploiting the slope detection. And he tried to explain it to me. Hey, this might work. Yes! Yeah. That was pretty fast. So...
I've never seen that before. I'm the one who made the level.
So, it's something to do with the diagonal slope of the roundabout thing that he was standing on keeps being detected while he's in the air. So when he flutters toward the corner, it thinks he's still on that slope and lets him just barely out of bounds. Fladervy tried to explain that to me in the practice rooms, and I didn't understand all of what he was talking about.
Yeah, I think I know what's going on there. Like, it's because of the way that the game handles, like, different layers when like, doing loops and stuff.
Fladervy just took a big risk in trying to boost between those pounders. He boosted past the first pounder just before the second pounder. Like, they all come down at the same time, but before the second pounder came down. That was a huge risk. Those pounders are an insta-kill. No matter, yeah, like, and there's no situation in which you can survive them. There's no way to be invincible to that. Mila is actually one of the hardest characters, even casually, partly because she has less health, but a lot of it is because she has no source of invincibility. Lilac has her dragon boost, and Carol has the wild kick attack, but Mila has no such thing.
Yeah, hers is kind of that you can reflect projectiles, but it's not true invincibility.
Yeah.
And one of the things I want to improve with her on the sequel is also to actually, like, give her, like, a faster regular attack. Because a lot of her attacks are charge-based. Like,
yeah.
So you have to spend time charging up the block first. The only one that doesn't is her weak shield stabbing move.
Yep.
So in this sequel, she has some regular punches and kicks.
Come on.
No.
Aww. You may have seen it. If you were watching closely, you would have seen earlier in the fight. He set off a laser, and it ended up putting Mila in a laser recoil, like a laser shot sprite, just for, like, permanently, just a little bit down to the ladder. It's a ladder glitch.
Unexpected smup stage.
There's some of us like this stage, some of us don't. I personally like it because it's kind of a breather before Battle Glacier.
Yeah, I just hold you forward.
Yeah.
And shooting.
Some people don't like it because it kind of increases the tension before Battle Glacier, which is the next stage. And even though Mila has an easier time than anybody else in Battle Glacier because she can skip parts of the stage, it's still one of her harder stages. She does make the boss look like a chump. For
nice.
A certain
yeah.
reason. But yeah, Battle Glacier.
Yeah, the smuff isn't actually like a true auto scroller, because if you hold right, you'll actually go faster. Like, the distance meter will decrease faster.
By the way, kudos for having your longest and hardest stage also be one of the coolest stages in the game. Even though I don't really like practicing Battle Glacier a whole lot, seeing a good, solid Battle Glacier run is one of the most impressive things in this game, because there's so much intense platforming and interesting tricks.
Awesome. Glad it turned out that way.
there's a lot of because Mila has less health, she relies heavily on shields. She gets a bonus hit versus the other characters on shields. For example, on normal mode, Lilac and Carol will get 2 hits on a shield, while Mila gets 3 before it disappears. In hard mode, Mila gets 2 hits, and the others get only 1.
That's why I needed to shoot at the beginning.
So this stage, both for Lilac and for Mila, is heavily about managing your shield, making sure you have a shield at a specific points so that you can soak certain attacks. There's a lot of... It's interesting that Mila is both the most fragile character and the one that takes advantage of the most damage boosts in the game. Because whereas Lilac has the advantage of being able to dragon boost through enemies, Mila just has to recoil herself forward and then tank a hit.
Yeah, she's kind of a glass cannon.
She's a glass cannon made out of cute.
More.
Wait.
Oh. Yeah, these rockets are tricky to control. You want them to all just... Nice. That's not a big time saver, but... That's a difficult trick to do. It's coming at a quick speed to that trick. Strategy for this boss is pretty much the same as for Lilac. It's when he goes for a jump, he'll move based on your current direction and speed. So if you're moving the same direction he's facing, I guess it would be this way for the viewers, then when he goes for a jump, he'll jump in place. Whereas if you're moving the other direction, he'll jump way far back and you'll end up in his sights. So by manipulating him to stay still, it makes the fight much more manageable. Oh that was an accidental zip. That was because he got pinched between the corner of a platform and the ceiling. Lilac has a new zip in this area that does that on purpose as well. He's about to try it here as Mila. This is the backup for Mila. It's the only... Oh, okay, good. Being in that room for Lilac would mean being trapped in there. I forgot that Mila can't actually get out of there because she does zips on pretty much any object. So you went through the ceiling here. What was that about? Is that a new... Was it because you triggered the loading zone already?
No, it's a fake wall, actually.
Oh, it's a fake... I didn't know that. I've never tried to go up through that. I thought maybe it was because you'd already triggered the loading zone, the game didn't care. Really tiny zip here. Nice. That just saves a very small corner. Mila just doesn't even care about this block maze. She just warps through the floor. This is one of the hardest things to do as Mila. Because the timing is so strict. There we go. Because you're coming down at such a high speed, and you have to try to buffer at a specific location, and then out of the buffer, you need to be ready to let go of the boost and start fluttering. So this has been around for a very long time, this zip. It's just you dismount, and the game tries to remount that. It used to be a mini boss that we would fight, but we skipped that now. So that guy's, the mount's name is Sparky. That was come up with by a member of the speedrun community quite a while ago. So this boss is one of the hardest in the game for Lilac. But Mila just goes face the entire time. Yeah, if you have Fire Shield coming in there, because of her flutter, Mila can hover in the boss's face and just get hit after hit. Makes the fight trivial.
And for this particular boss, what matters is the amount of hits you do and not the damage.
Yeah, because the Fire Shield is normally very low
damage. Yeah, the Fire Shield repeatedly damages enemies that you're overlapping.
But it's low damage per tick. It's like one or two.
One damage per tick.
Yeah. So normally it would be useless, but certain, like each boss or major enemy has a different way it's damaged. Some will take a certain amount of hits of any kind. Some will have a health bar And then once that health bar depletes, like their overall health bar will go down by one unit, like the boss of Fortune Knight. And then some bosses just have an overall damage counter. So because Dale goes by straight hits and not any kind of damage, the fire shield is very useful there. And it just happens to be on the way because it's during, you get it for free because it's in the ground. Like you saw him burrow it up during the Absolution mini boss fight, that green ship. While the boss is flying through the background, you can dig that up. So it's free to get the fire shield there, and you just have to keep it through the stage.
Yeah, I haven't seen a lot of people like think to try and dig in the ground there. But it's a nice little Easter egg if you can find that shield.
There's a lot of unusual places you can dig in the ground and find. A lot of people don't know about Mila's digging mechanic.
Yeah, I kind of did a bad job explaining it.
Well, it's just not something that seems all that useful. Because, like, even playing casually, a lot of people don't care about just getting random crystals out of the ground, and that's what you mostly get in Aqua Tunnel.
I think if I were to do it differently, I could, like, make it, like, an all-purpose healing mechanic, where if you dig, you, like, always have a chance of restoring life.
Interesting.
That'd be something to think about for this.
Would that be luck-based, though? One of the things we really like about...
I don't think so.
One of the things we really like about this game is that it seems to have very little luck. There's a few points of luck on specific boss fights. Like in the third stage boss, Robo Panther, he can do either 2 or 3 machine gun shots per salvo. This fight is completely scripted. RNG. Neither are we, so it's the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
Like there's cases where it'll be kind of random, but it like draws from a pool. It's kind of like shuffling like a deck of cards, and then they'll pick an attack from the deck.
Yeah, or there's a lot of things that seem random to a casual player, but are actually results of the player's movement. Like Spade in Lilac's Sky Battalion seems very random, but it is in fact completely controllable by the player.
Exactly.
Same thing with Brevin on normal mode, the last boss fight. By the way, bravo on trolling the speedrun community with the Mila adventure mode ending. When like the Brevin 3 fight looked like it was about to start, I was like, oh, do we have to fight him now? And then it turned out to be a cutscene. Lilac just flew in from the right.
Okay.
Nope.
You got us, sir. Yeah, this is, like, right there you see him in taking a recoil boost and launching himself through an enemy, taking damage in the process. And this is one of the more dangerous stages in the game.
I need these bombs to zip, so I had to restart.
Yeah, these bombs are right at the beginning of the screen, yeah, so he can just restart and immediately try that again. Bombs are kind of the worst thing to have to zip on, because even if you let them fall back safely to the ground, they're going to explode. Mila can do that the box zip. What she's doing is she's jumping, starting the creation of a block, which will, when she makes contact with an object that she can carry below her, will reverse her position with the crate so that she's now carrying it instead of the block she made. So right here, he was creating a block in midair, and then when he was halfway through the block, so Mila's sprite was over top of the block, he let go of the block charging, which stopped the swap happening and started a zip. And this fight, Giga Serpentine, this is one of the fights that changes on hard mode. Giga Serpentine is much faster on hard mode than normal. A lot of people don't know this. Mila's block can reflect just like her shields can. Which makes for some hilarious boss strategies. That is a very intense fight, though, by any character on any difficulty, and especially for Mila. It's a huge, like... So that stage would normally take you 3 minutes. He just did it in 1.5 minutes because of zips. Nice. So, like, one of the nice things about Mila is that there is no final Brevin fight. There's 3 bosses at the end of the game, and the third one is not fought by Mila. And that's a really good thing for Fladervy, because the change to the final Brevin fight is that on hard, the attacks come out in a random pattern instead of a fixed pattern. So Lilac runners run on normal, Mila runners tend to run on hard for that reason. For partly that reason.
Oof. Yeah, like with the final Brevin fight, I figured that like Mila, because all of her attacks are charge based, I figured that she would have way too difficult of a time.
That was the right
for
call.
The average
yeah.
player.
Yeah.
But like, if you play in adventure mode, there's a cutscene that explains why she doesn't fight Brevin's final form.
Yeah, although probably if you had left it in, Fladervy could have defeated him nearly as quickly as, like, both Lilac and Carol can beat the final Brevin fight in, like, I think it's 6 seconds if you use the best strat possible, which is extremely hard.
Yeah.
So I think with Flattervy's skill, he could probably rival that with Mila. But for, like, a first-time player, it would be an awful fight.
Yeah, exactly.
Brevin 3 is one of the coolest fights in the game. The first time I played it, I was having the time of my life, because it's like a Dark Souls boss. You're just bewildered at first, and you have no idea what you're doing, and then slowly you start figuring out the pattern.
Yeah, also, that's what I was shooting for.
Also, the reason Mila didn't fight a boss there is because that boss fight would have been Mila. In the Lilac run, you may have noticed Mila is captured by Brevin and then is poisoned, or I think it's... I don't know what the lore reason is for her transformation. Only she and Serpentine transform. So my going theory is that Mila might be a lab experiment from Brevin's ship that escaped. But I don't... I'm not going to ask you if that's true or not. I don't know if you're willing to answer.
I can say that we kind of elaborate on that in the sequel.
Okay. I'm excited then. But yeah, like in the scene before that, and okay, I need to explain this actually, because this is this giant laser shaft makes the ending of Freedom Planet fights, Freedom Planet runs really stressful, but because of this zip right here, it's not stressful any longer for Mila. That is death, by the way. You cannot escape from that laser as Mila. Nice. But yeah, the final Brevin fight is the best boss fight in the game, I'm sure. We're going to see a second bout with Absolution, Brevin's escape ship here, or attack ship or whatever. Same deal as before. And then... Oh, nice. Knocked it out of the sky. That was a fast fight. And then the second form, this is actually the last form Mila's going to face, the mech. So we're coming up on time here. All of this mech's shots can be reflected, which makes this fight surprisingly easy, even for a first-time player. I mean, Fladervy doesn't care. He just flies up in the boss's face anyway and says, I don't even need your lasers to kill you. Okay, that's time.
And that kid immediately skipped the cutscene. That's time.
That was time there. It's fine though.
What was the time?
It was what now? That was, okay, we go by in-game time in the speedrun community for this, so I'm not sure what that works out to. We're going to find out. Also, Quack. The duck guard in the credits is a meme in the Ethereum Planet community.
Should be 33 in game time.
Okay. Nice.
Barely.
The record for Mila is 31. That's better than this is like Mila runs tend to vary more widely than Lilac runs because there's so many tricks that are so precise and have a high chance of failure. And Flad's been getting 34s and he was getting discouraged, but he got a 33 in the final run. Excellent job.
Awesome, you did good. Did great.
Any thoughts, Strife?
Yeah, I really appreciate you coming to the US to show us your stuff. Thank you so much. And thank you to all of our fans who helped make this run possible. They actually hosted kind of a marathon on Twitch a while back to raise money for his trip.
That's the reason for the t-shirt I'm wearing right now. This was actually this image on my t-shirt was one of the donation comments for that fundraiser stream, so thank you. We had to raise quite a bit of money to get Fladervy here. They said that the process to get him through the paperwork was not easy for him. He was really worried.
It ended up working out.
Yeah. Worked out at the last possible minute.
Yeah, I'll say.
Yeah. Yay, Superdog.
But yeah, thank you for having me. And thank you to all of our fans for supporting us.
All right, good job on that run, Fladervy. I'm going to take a moment to catch up on a lot of donations we had during that run. A lot of big ones. They lead me by person. We have $250 from my Alexi.
You're welcome.
Hey, Vlad. Sorry I couldn't be there in person. Hopefully this at least partially makes up for it. Good luck and have fun. Here's to the Super Dog. Money to runner's choice. P.S. I like the shirt. Cat boo. We have $50 from Wandering Mind. I've been watching the GDQs since SGDQ 2012. It's amazing to see how SGDQ has grown from the small marathon that took place in Essentia's house to the marathon that it is today. As always, I'm glad to see this event happen for a great cause. Super Dog hype. Money goes to my pal, Half Coordinated, for the controller cam on his Momodoro run, which actually was met, by the way. We'll be doing that in the next run.